This lecture is about columns, which is chapter 10 of the textbook of Mechanics of Materials by Beer and Johnson. These lectures are available, the PDF slides are available on my website. Actually, these lectures are property of the publishers of the book, McGraw-Hill. I want to give credit to them. I have slightly modified some of the slides. These video lectures are also available on my YouTube. So we are moving towards the chapter. Before going in depth, I want to differentiate between some basic topics like column and beam. Mostly, the most famous confusion among the students is the difference between a column and a beam. Mostly people consider that columns are vertical and beams are horizontal. They think it is the only difference between beams and columns, but it is not. What is beam? Beam is actually a structural member which supports bending moment, or we can say it is under transverse load. The load is perpendicular to the axis of the beam, longitudinal axis of the beam. And columns are usually considered vertical, and like this, and load is applied along the axis of the beam. Now I want to draw another figure here, horizontal figure, where load is along the axis of the structure, and here I want to draw a vertical structure which is fixed at one end, and there is a load perpendicular to the axis of the structure. Now this is column. This is column. This is beam. This is also a beam. So we can see in column, the load is along the axis of the column, axis of the structure, the longitudinal axis. In beams, the load is perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. This is called transverse load. Transverse loading. And this is axial loading. So definition of, or the difference between a beam and a column is, a beam is under a bending moment or a transverse load, and a column is always under axial load. It supports axial loading. So it is not necessary that a column will always be vertical and a beam will be horizontal. Beam can be vertical and a column can be horizontal. So the column or beam cannot be defined by the orientation of the structure. It can be defined by the type of loading they are bearing. If the loading type is transverse or bending moment, it is called beam, and if the load is axial, the structure is called column. If both of the loads are applied at the same time, bending and for example this one, if a structure is under axial as well as transverse load, it is called beam column. This is beam column. So difference between beam and column can now be understood well by the students, that a beam is a structure under transverse load or bending moment, and a column is a structure under axial load. So there is no dependency on the orientation of the structure. Okay. Before moving further, I want to discuss a few more things. In the previous chapters until now, what we have discussed is strength of the material. We have discussed strength, sigma, and ability of the structure to support specific load without undergoing unacceptable deformation. So we have strength and deformation. delta maximum. We have, until now we have discussed how much a material can bear the load, ultimate strength or yield strength, and how much it can be deformed. This is what we have discussed in the previous chapters. But now in this chapter we are concerned with the stability of the structure, stability of the column specifically. In this chapter we are discussing about columns. So stability is the ability to support a given load without experiencing a sudden change in configuration. So a column can buckle actually. We have a column and we apply load on it, so it can buckle. How much this buckling can be, and will it be stable after buckling or it will be unstable, this will be discussed in this chapter. We will discuss for a specific length of the column L and specific cross-sectional area either this load P is critical or not. So we will determine critical load. Critical load for different types of columns in this chapter. What will be the different types of columns? The type of column can be differentiated by the type of boundary conditions. Either both ends of the column are pinned, or one end is fixed and the other end is free, or one end is fixed and the other end is pinned, or both ends are fixed. We will discuss different types of boundary conditions in this chapter. Okay, moving further, stability of the structures, we can discuss design of a column in terms of strength or in terms of deflection as deformation, as we have discussed here, strength or deformation. So in the design of columns, cross-sectional area is selected such that sigma is equal to P over A. In a column, if I want to design a column, this area, cross-sectional area, since it is under compressive load, axial load, so force stress is equal to force divided by area. This applied stress should be less than the allowable strength of the stress of the material. Allowable is equal to, if it is a ductile material, it is sigma yield by factor of safety, and if it is a brittle material, it is sigma ultimate by factor of safety. Okay, similarly, like first we can define that allowable stress should not be exceeded. Secondly, we have to define that deformation falls within the specifications. What are the specifications? What is deformation actually? Axial deformation, we have already studied. Axial deformations are P L over A, E, where P is load, L is length, A is cross-sectional area, and E is modulus of elasticity. So this deformation should not be greater than specified deformation. Specification can be different for different structures. So after these two design considerations, first consideration is the allowable stress should not be exceeded, and the second one is the deformation falls within the specifications. After these design calculations, we may discover that the column is unstable under the loading and that it suddenly becomes sharply curved or buckles. If these conditions are satisfied, then we may discover it or not. Okay, how? We are considering here a model of two rods and a torsional spring. After let us consider here rod AC and rod BC A B C, they are connected or they are pinned at point C, and then there is a coil spring attached at point C. We are applying compressive force P at the ends A and B. This compressive force is trying to disturb this assembly as given in this figure. It is disturbed. The spring tries to restore this disturbance. So one moment is applied due to the applied loads P, applied load P, and then another moment is applied by the restoring spring at point C to bring back this assembly back to its original position. You may have seen these kind of springs in old watches, alarm watches, and these springs are called torsional springs. Okay, first we consider that this deformation is stable. This from one equilibrium position, the body has moved to another equilibrium position, but there is still stability in the structure, and we consider that this angle del theta is a very small angle. Okay, after disturbance, let us do some calculations to find the critical load. One moment is produced by the spring and the other is produced by the load. The moment produced by spring is restoring moment. M restoring moment, M restoring is K is spring constant, and this angle is 2 del theta. Why it is 2 del theta? Because with the vertical axis the angle is del theta. So del theta plus del theta, this total angle is 2 del theta. This is moment produced by the torsional spring, and then there is another moment which is produced by the load. Half this moment in this diagram, we can see if we move this force P to point C, in this diagram we can see that this moment M can be calculated. M is equal to P L by 2 into sine of del theta. Here we can make this a triangle and then you can calculate this distance. Okay. Sine of del theta. As we have earlier mentioned that del theta is a very small angle. So sine of a small angle is almost equal to angle itself, but remember it should be in radians. So we can rewrite it as P L by 2 del theta. This moment is produced by the load. We are calling it destabilizing moment. Destabilizing moment. So the column is stable or tends to return to its aligned orientation if the destabilizing moment is less than the restoring moment. I am calling the restoring moment equal to MR. Destabilizing is MD. Okay, so the column will be stable or it will return to its aligned orientation if the destabilizing moment is less than the restoring moment. So the column will restore to its original position. If restoring moment is less than the destabilizing moment, the column will not come back to its aligned orientation. So by putting the values P L by 2 del theta should be less than K 2 del theta, or if we rearrange it, P should be less than 4 k by L. This 4k by L is actually p critical is 4k by L. So p should be less than p critical. If p is less than p critical, the column will restore to its original position. And we have already assumed that MD is less than MR. MD stabilizing moment is less than restoring moment. So we have got p less than 4k by L. 4k by L is actually the critical load for this case. Okay, now again we assume the same configuration, but this time we are assuming an angle theta, which is a large angle, not a small angle. So again a similar configuration, but this time the angle is not a small angle. We cannot assume sine of angle theta equal to angle theta. Again, in this case, the restoring moment of the spring is k 2 theta. Now we are not using del theta, it is a bigger angle theta. Okay, and the destabilizing moment is equal to p L by 2 sine theta, similar to the previous case. Okay, but now we are considering that the restoring moment is not, sorry, the destabilizing moment is not less than the restoring moment. So, sorry. So, P L by 2 sine theta is equal to the restoring moment K to theta. Now we are assuming that the angle is bigger angles, not a small angle, so sine theta is not equal to theta itself. We can rewrite this expression as P L by 4k equal to theta by sine theta, or P L by 4k. We already discovered in the previous slide that 4k by L is p critical. So we can also write it as p by p critical. Okay, now we know that theta is not a small angle, so theta and sine theta are not equal, and for greater angles sine theta is less than theta usually. So if sine theta is less than theta, this term will be greater than 1. If this term is greater than 1, p by p critical is equal to greater than 1. It can be any number, but greater than 1. It means p is greater than p critical. If p is greater than p critical, it means the column is not stable. It will not come back to its original alignment, original position, because the load, applied load, has already exceeded the critical load of the column. What is the critical load of the column? P critical, it is 4k by L, where k is the spring constant of the torsional spring or the restoring spring, and L is total length of the column. So in this case, P is greater than P critical. If P is greater than P critical, the moment the structure is not stable under the given load. And if P is less than P critical, as in the previous case, the structure or column in this case is stable, and it will come back to its original position after the load is removed. So we have discussed the stability of columns. There are two possibilities: either it is stable or it is unstable. When is it stable or when it is unstable? If the applied load is less than the critical load of the column, it is stable. The column is stable. And if the applied load is greater than the critical load, the column is unstable under that specific load P. Okay, then we have to change the design or decrease the applied load. Okay, moving further, our next topic is Euler formula for pin-ended beams or columns. Here we have considered a column. Both ends of the column are pinned. The column is pinned at this end and pinned at this end as well. And then we are applying load P. Okay, so this is the free body diagram of the both end pinned column. If both ends of the column are pinned, okay, again, one thing we have to remember is in this chapter throughout, we will discuss the length of the column in terms of x. Here, the x seems to be vertical, but it is along the length, and the deflection of the column will be directed in y direction. Deflection will be measured, deformation. We call the deformation in columns as buckling. The buckling is measured in terms of y, and length of the column is measured in terms of x. Okay. So here in this case, vertical dimension is x and horizontal dimension is y. At pinned ends, the column cannot move. So at x equal to 0, y is 0, and if the total length is L, so at x equal to L, y is 0. Again, we have these two boundary conditions. Consider this column. After a small perturbation, the system reaches an equilibrium configuration such that we already know that d square y by dx square is equal to m over ei. We have studied this in our chapter number 9. Okay, this expression is similar to bending expression because the curvature, if the curvature is in within elastic limit. Okay, the moment here in this case, if we section the column at any point, for example, we are sectioning it at point Q and we are drawing a free body diagram, the moment is equal to minus P y. Okay, if we rearrange this expression, it will be d square y by dx square plus P y over e I equal to 0. Okay, P over e I, let us assume that P over E I, P over E I, we assume that P over E I, capital P over E I is equal to small p. So we can rearrange this expression and we can write a famous differential expression. We are assuming it is equal to small p square because it is a constant. So we can rewrite this expression as d square y by dx square plus small p square y equal to 0. Okay. This expression is a differential equation for simple harmonic motion, except the independent variable is now the distance x instead of y. If you remember the simple harmonic motion differential equation, it is of a similar type, but instead of x, the variable is time t in simple harmonic motion, but it is a similar expression. So we have a similar solution. If you solve a simple harmonic motion differential equation, You can do it, and it is available in books of mathematics and also in the same book of mechanics of material, chapter number 10. If you go to the volume number, the edition 7, it is on page number 695. Solution of the expression is there. I am not going into the solution of this differential equation, but I will simplify it, and we can calculate P critical will be equal to pi square EI over L square. This is P critical. Over applied P should be less than P critical. Otherwise, the column will be unstable. So by solving this differential equation and applying these two boundary conditions at x equal to 0, y 0 and x equal to L, y 0, we can simplify. The simplification steps are available in the textbook. I have already mentioned to go to page number 695, chapter number 10 of the 7th edition of the Mechanics of Material by Pierre and Johnson. So we can simplify, and P critical is obtained as pi square E I over L square. So we will use this expression continuously in this chapter to calculate critical load for pin-ended columns. Okay, and this is called Euler formula. We can also calculate critical stress. Critical stress will be equal to critical load divided by area. Okay, pi square E I over L square A. Okay, here we can do some more simplification. We know that I is equal to A R square. I is second moment of area or moment of inertia. A is area and R is radius of gyration. You have already discussed or already studied this topic in the engineering physics course, radius of gyration. What is radius of gyration? I will simply revise or simply define it here again for those students who have missed the definition of radius of gyration. Radius of gyration is defined as the distance from a given axis up to a point on the area where the entire area is assumed to be concentrated. I will shortly revise it here. For example, here is an area and it has a distance r from x-axis. If the whole area is concentrated at this point, and the distance of this point from x-axis is r, so Ixx will be area into r square. This r is called radius of gyration. I will redefine it. Radius of gyration is the distance from axis to a given point on an area where the entire area is assumed to be concentrated. Okay, so here I will write I equal to AR square. We can cancel out area with area, and critical stress will be pi square E divided by L by R square. So this is critical stress. Our applied stress should be less than the critical stress in order to make or to define design a stable column. If the applied stress is not less than or it is greater than critical stress, the column will be unstable. Okay, so Here we can, this expression is actually critical stress, where L over R is called slenderness ratio. It is a very important term. We will keep on using this term, slenderness ratio, and half the column stability depend upon slenderness ratio. The more is the slenderness ratio, L over R, the lesser will be the strength of the structure or column. Or alternatively, we can say the lower is the slenderness ratio, the higher will be the strength of the column. So we need to keep the slenderness ratio as low as possible to get the maximum strength of the column. Okay, to keep the slenderness ratio small, L over R small, we need to have smaller length and bigger cross sections. So we have to define columns such that the slenderness ratio is as that the column has greater strength, greater critical stress. If we plot this expression of critical stress with slenderness ratio L over R in this graph on this slide, we can see strength of the this is for a specific material. I think it is for structural steel. The vertical axis is stress, horizontal axis is L over R. If we draw the curve, it is this curve. As soon as we increase L over R, or the slenderness ratio, the strength of the column decreases. And as soon as the slenderness ratio decreases, strength of the column increases. But up till which limit it can increase? There is a limit which is called yield strength. Above the yield strength, the column, if the column does not fail due to its stability or compressive stress, it may fail due to its material, which is yield strength of the material. So if we exceed the yield strength of the material, we do not need to study the stability of the column. We have to study about the material because we have exceeded the material properties. So this expression is actually valid for elastic properties or elastic loads, if the column is under elastic loads. So this curve, Euler curve, is valid only until yield limit of the material. Beyond yield limit, this expression is invalid and the material, the structure will fail due to the yielding of the material. Okay, so for us it is important to remember this expression, P critical equal to pi square EI over L square, or sigma critical is equal to pi square E over L by R square, where L over R is slenderness ratio, L is length of the column, R is radius of gyration. Okay, this expression is actually derived for pin-ended column, when both ends of the column are pinned. Okay, so I will write it here, P critical equal to pi square EI over LE square. I'm writing length as LE. E means effective. This is effective length. Why I have written this expression? We will use it for other columns as well. Okay, for pin ended columns, or for both ends pinned, pin ended column, effective length is actually length of the column, total length of the column. But for other types of columns, for example, we have a column where one end is fixed and the other end is free. If the load is applied on such column, on the free end of the load, free end of the column will buckle like this. Like this. A column with one end fixed and one end free will behave as the upper half of the pin connected column. A pin connected column buckles like this. Sorry, pin ended column buckles like this. So this deformation is like upper half of the pin ended column, and the remaining lower half is a mirror image of the upper half, this one. So it is like this. If we see, the effective length is equal to twice the length of the given length of the column. So for a column where one end is fixed and other is free, we can assume LE equal to twice the length of the column, and we will use the same expression, same Euler expression which was derived for the pin ended column, but here pi square EI is divided by square of effective length, and effective length is equal to 2L. So similarly, sigma critical or critical stress is also equal to pi, the same expression, pi square E over LE by R square. Here the slenderness ratio is equal to LE by R, where LE is effective length. In some books it is called equivalent length. Is effective. Okay. So this expression will be used for all types of columns, but the effective length will be different for different types of columns. You can see in the book the different types of effective lengths for different types of columns. Here I will show you just a summary. For a column where one end is fixed and one end is free, effective length is twice the length of the column. For columns where both ends are pinned, we have already derived other formula for such columns. Effective length is equal to the total length of the column, the given length of the column. For the columns where one end is fixed and one end is pinned, this end is fixed and the upper end is pinned, effective length is 0.7 times the length of the column. We do not need to prove it here. The data is already available in the book. We will just apply it on the numerical problems. Okay. For a column with both ends fixed, the effective length is equal to half of the given length. Effective length is the length which is deformed, actually. The mode of deformation is different in all types of columns shown on this slide. There are four types of columns shown on this slide. The one with one end fixed, other end free, one with both ends pinned, one with one end fixed, other end pinned, and the last one, both ends fixed. Okay. Moving further to a numerical problem. Okay, before this problem, I want to discuss one more interesting fact. If a column is buckling, if here is a column, for example, this end is fixed and the other end is free and load is applied. There are three axes, x, y, z. The column length is in y axis. The column may buckle if a force P is applied. The column may buckle either in YZ plane or in XY plane. So in which direction or in which plane will it buckle? The plane with minimum I has more chances of buckling as compared to the plane with maximum I. P critical is equal to pi square E I over L E square. Okay. If L is same, because in this column it is fixed at the bottom, it is free on the top, it is free in either XY plane or in YZ plane. So LE is same for both cases. E is constant, pi is constant, so I is different. So column will tend to buckle in the plane with minimum I, or we can say that P critical, sorry, previously we have written the same expression in terms of L over R ratios. So sigma critical is equal to pi square E divided by L over R square. So the plane with greater L over R will show less resistance to the buckling, and the plane and the column will buckle in the plane with greater L over R ratio. So we can find L over R ratio in both the planes XY and YZ in the plane which has greater L over R ratio, or the plane which has minimum I, the column will try to buckle in that plane. So the upcoming problem is on a similar topic. Here's a column given where one end is fixed. The bottom end of the column is fixed at point B. At point A, a load P is applied, axial load. An aluminium column of length L and rectangular cross section has a fixed end at B, and it supports a centric load at A. Okay, centric load is very important. Remember that Euler formula which we have studied until now, it is for centric loading only. We have not discussed any eccentricity until now. So this expression of Euler formula is valid for centric loading only. Okay. Two smooth and round fixed plates restrain an A from moving in one of the vertical planes of symmetry. Here are two round ended plates, this one and this one. As the ends are round and smooth, so we consider that the column can rotate around rotate on the surfaces of these round ended plates in the XY plane. This is X direction. Okay, so this end of the column, end A of the column is pinned, is like a pinned connection in the XY plane, or we can say around the Z axis. Okay, but these plates do not let the column move in the Y direction. So it means it is fixed in the
sorry, sorry, sorry. This column can move in the z direction. So this end is free in the xz plane, or it can freely rotate. This end can freely rotate around y axis, but this end cannot move or cannot translate in y direction, but it can rotate here because these ends are smooth and rounded. So at point A, the column can rotate actually. It is like a pinned connection. Here we will assume that this is, if I redraw it as the two-dimensional structure, okay, in the xy plane, xy plane, sorry, xz plane, this width is A, so one end is fixed, this is fixed end, and this is free because in z direction it can translate and there is no moment. Okay, if we draw a two-dimensional diagram of this column in xy direction, it is like a pin support here because it can rotate around this point, but it cannot translate here in the y direction. It cannot translate in the y direction, but it can rotate here because these plates are round and smooth. Okay, what we are asked, we have been asked here, determine the ratio AB. Okay, B is width in xy plane and A is width in, sorry, B is width in xz plane. B is width in xz plane. Sorry, this is B and A is width in xy plane. Okay, determine the ratio A over B of the two sides of the cross section corresponding to the most efficient design against buckling. This is very important. Most efficient design against buckling. The efficient design of a column against buckling is the kind of design where the tendency of deflection in both the planes is similar, either in xy plane or either in xz plane. So it means I y I about y axis is equal to I about z axis. If moment of inertia is same in both the planes, or we can say if slenderness ratio is same about both the axes y and z. As x is actually length of the beam, so rotation is either possible in y axis, around y axis, or z axis. So slenderness ratio in around both the axes should be same, or I should be same, then we can call it most efficient design. So we will use this condition in this problem to solve the first part, and we will find a relationship between A or B, relationship between A and B, and we will write their ratio. In the second part, we are asked to design the most efficient cross section for this column. After finding ratio of A over B, we will put numerical values of length, E, load, and factor of safety, and we can find numerical values of A and B. Okay, since factor of safety is given, remember that whenever factor of safety is given, remember factor of safety is equal to P critical divided by P. Sorry, P divided by P critical. Factor of safety is equal to P divided by P critical. Okay. So we are moving further towards the solution of this problem. Okay, to find radius of gyration, we have already discussed that I is equal to AR square. So IZ will be equal to ARZ square. So we can find RZ equal to IZ divided by A. What is IZ? Moment, a second moment of, moment of inertia around Z axis. Finding moment, it is simply a rectangle. The cross section is a rectangle. So this is a cross section A and B. This is Z direction, and this is Z direction, and this is Y direction. Okay. Since Z is perpendicular to the A face of the cross section area, so it will be 1 over 12 B A cube divided by area. Area is A into B. So we have found RZ equal to A by square root of 12. Now we can find LE by R. LE by R, yeah. LEZ divided by RZ. So LEZ, what is LEZ? When this column rotates around Z axis, we have previously discussed that when it rotates around Z axis, this case it is in XY plane. This end is considered as pin end, and the other end is fixed. One end fixed and the other end is pinned. For such kind of columns where one end is fixed and other end is pinned, effective length is 0.7 times the given length. So here we have calculated LEZ as 0.7 times the given length. So 0.7 times the given length divided by RZ is A over square root of 12. So here becomes a total LE over R around Z axis. Similarly, using the same expression again, radius of gyration around Y axis, IY divided by A is equal to RY square. In the Y direction, if we see, if the rotation is around Y axis, Y is perpendicular to the face B, so it will be 1 over 12 AB cube divided by AB. AB is area, small AB. So we can simplify it. RY, a radius of gyration when rotation is around Y axis, it becomes B over square root of 12. So LE divided by R, if we consider rotation around Y axis, here is our case where rotation is around Y axis and the beam is in, and the rotation is actually in XZ plane. So one end of the beam is fixed and the other end is free. Beams with one end fixed and other end free, effective length is 2 times the given length. So here effective length when rotation is around Y axis equal to 2 times given length. So 2L divided by RY, it becomes LE divided by R when rotation is around Y axis. For the most efficient design against buckling, these two slenderness ratios must be same, And by putting in this expression, we have got A over B equal to 0.35. This was required in the first part of the problem. In the second part, we are asked to determine the most efficient cross section. Most efficient cross section means to find the cross sectional dimensions when the design is most efficient. So for most efficient design, this is ratio of A over B. If we know any one of them, either A or B, we can find both A and B. So by putting these numerical values, okay, we can solve. And now we already know that deflection in both of the planes is similar. L by R is same about y axis, R about z axis. We can consider deflection in any of these planes. Let us consider deflection in plane y. Putting the numerical values given of length equal to 20 inches, E equal to 10.1 into 10 power 6 pound per square inch, P equal to 5 into 10 power 3 pounds, and factor of safety equal to 2.5. Here is L over R equal to 138.8 divided by B. P critical is equal to factor of safety into P. Factor of safety is given and P is given, so we have found P critical. We know that sigma critical is equal to P critical divided by A. So we can put values of P critical and area A. Area A is equal to small a into B. Since small a divided by B is 0.35, so we can write it is 0.35 B into B. This is one expression of sigma critical, which has been obtained by dividing P critical over A. Another expression of sigma critical is pi square E divided by L E R square. Since L E by R is same for is same about y axis and about z axis, so we can use any one of them. I am using here L E by R around y axis. So we have found already the values. Sigma critical from this expression is here. We can compare these two sigma criticals here. In this expression, only B is unknown. The B has been calculated. It is 1.62. By putting B into the ratio of A over B, we can find A as well. So these are dimensions of the cross section, A and B. A and B. This is the most efficient design of the column, or most efficient cross section of the column. Okay, what we have done, we were asked to find the cross section A over B ratios for the most efficient design against buckling. I will remind you, for the most efficient design, either I should be same in both the planes or slenderness ratios should be same in both the planes. So we have considered this one. For slenderness ratio to be same in both the planes, we have found slenderness ratios in plane XY and in plane XZ, around the rotation around Z axis and rotation around Y axis. For rotation around Z axis, beam is considered with one end fixed and other end free, other end pinned. For rotation around Y axis, we have considered beam one end fixed and other end free. By putting all the values in this expression, we have found ratio of A over B. Then again, comparing sigma critical from this expression P critical over A and sigma critical from the expression pi square E over L E by R square, we have simplified and found B. If we know B and we know this ratio of A over B, we can find A as well. This is all. Remember just this point, for the most critical design, either I should be same in both the planes or slenderness ratio should be same in both the planes. Okay, moving further. This Euler formula was for loads, for centric loads only. Now we are moving towards eccentric loads. For eccentric loads, we have secant formula. What is eccentric load? If the load does not pass through the centroidal axis of the column, and there is an offset distance between the load and the centroidal axis. Here in this case, we consider a distance E between the centroidal axis and the applied load. So due to this distance, a moment will be created. We have already discussed eccentric loading in the initial chapters of this course, I think in chapter number 2, axial loading chapter. So due to eccentric loading, if we want to shift this load P to centroidal axis of the column, we want to make it centric load. So we have to apply a moment or a couple equal to PE. So the force is replaced with the force couple system at both the ends. Now if this column buckles, it buckles due to the applied load P and the moment PE. There will be a maximum deflection here, and we are interested in the maximum deflection to find this maximum deflection, also to find the sigma maximum in this case. Okay. So eccentric loading is equivalent to centric load and a couple. Centric load and a couple. Okay. Bending occurs for any non-zero eccentricity. Question of buckling becomes whether the resulting deflection is excessive or not. Okay. The deflection becomes infinite when P is equal to P critical. We have already discussed we should not exceed P critical. If we are exceeding P critical, then there will be excessive deflection. Okay. Previously we have discussed that d square y by dx square is equal to m over ei. Now this moment is not only because of load, but it is also because of this couple. Previously we had moment because of load only. Here was it. This moment was because of load py minus py. Now we have moment due to load and due to a couple, so it will be moment due to load minus py and moment due to couple minus pe divided by ei. And now if this expression is solved, this differential equation is solved, and we have boundary conditions x is equal to 0 at y is equal to 0, y is equal to 0 at x equal to 0, and y equal to 0 at x equal to L, the solution of this differential equation is given in the textbook. I will give you the relevant page number for this solution from the textbook. It is page number 710. You can see the solution of this differential equation on page number 710. I will simply write the end result. Y maximum is equal to eccentric distance E into secant of the angle pi by 2. Remember, this pi by 2 is in radius. Most of the students make this mistake. Pi by 2 is in radians. You have to convert your calculators to radians. P by P critical into, sorry, minus 1. P is the given load and P critical is already defined. It is pi square EI over LE square. Because we have moved the load to the centroidal axis, so P critical will be same as this as defined in the Euler formula. Similarly, maximum stress can also be calculated. In this case, how we can calculate maximum stress since column is under normal loading as well as in this case it is under bending load. We can see this column is under normal load P and a couple moment M. So the normal load is producing normal stress P over A, and the couple is producing bending stress MC over I. For maximum sigma, moment should be maximum. Where the moment is maximum? Moment is maximum where Y is maximum. So we can put corresponding values in this expression. Moment is maximum where Y is maximum, plus there is another moment equal to PE, which is MA. So we can rewrite it as putting this maximum moment in this expression, sigma maximum becomes P over A into 1 plus Y maximum plus E divided by R square. I have split it. This I is as AR square, and then we have taken A as common. Okay, so putting Y maximum from the previous slide, this Y maximum into this expression, and then simplifying it, you can do the simplification steps by yourself. Sigma maximum becomes P over A into 1 plus EC over R square secant of P over EI into L by 2. Remember, this angle is in radians. Do not make this mistake in your exams. Keep your calculators in radians. Okay. Or we can also simplify this expression by putting P critical is equal to pi square EI over LE square or L square. We can rearrange this expression as, you can do the rearrangement or the simplification steps. 1 plus EC by R square secant of pi by 2 square root of P over P critical. You put P critical equal to pi square EI over L square in this expression, you will get the first one. So we can use either of these expressions to find sigma maximum. You can either use these two expressions, or you can start from here to find maximum stress in the column under eccentric loads. We can also find P over A from this expression, keeping P over A on the on one side, and you can move all of the other terms on the other side, and you can plot P over A against L over R. I am writing here P over A in terms of the other terms. P over A will be equal to sigma maximum from this expression, sigma maximum divided by 1 plus AC by R square secant of 1 over 2 P over E A L E by R. Okay, now I want to plot P over A against slenderness ratio. This diagram is also given in our textbook. This is plotted for some material. I think it is for steel. This diagram is for English systems of unit. This is for SI systems of unit. If we keep changing EC over R ratio, this is eccentricity. E is eccentricity, C is radius of the beam, and R is radius of gyration. AC by R ratio, if we keep on changing it between 0 and 1, we can draw different graphs for LE by R against P over A. And if we see the last one, this curve, EC by R square is equal to 0, so this expression becomes as an Euler expression. And in all other expressions, we can see that as soon as we increase the slenderness ratio, the P over A is decreasing. And for lower slenderness ratio, P over A is higher. And the P over A also depends upon eccentricity ratios. So the eccentricity, the EC over R square ratio is not important at higher L over R ratios, but at lower L over R ratios there is a variation in the graph at for different EC over R ratios. For EC over R equal to 0, this expression itself is similar to Euler expression. But remember that no strength can be higher than the yield strength of the material. If you exceed the yield strength of the material, the column will fail due to the material property, not because of the column stability under the load, not because of its geometry, but it will fail due to material property. So we do not move, or we do not draw any graph beyond the yield strength of the material. Okay, moving further, we will solve a numerical problem using the same method, using the eccentricity method. Okay, the statement of the column is, the uniform column consists of an 8 feet section of structural tubing having the cross section shown. Here is a column with 8 feet length, and it is actually a tube cross section given here. The cross sectional values are given. It is 4 by 4 inch cross section, and the area is given, moment of inertia is given, radius of gyration is given, C half of the height, which is 2. Okay, using in part A, okay, the column is given here different for part A and B. For part A, it is a centric loading. The column is under centric loading. For part B, the column is under eccentric load. In part A, using Euler's formula and a factor of safety of 2, determine the allowable centric load for the column and the corresponding normal stress. So for part A, we have to find P, allowable RP, and then sigma, corresponding normal stress, using Euler formula. For part B, or remember that factor of safety is given, which is equal to 2. So if we find P critical, a factor of safety is given, so we can find P allowable. In part B, assuming that the allowable load found in part A is applied in the part B at a point 0.75 inch from the geometric axis of the column. So P found from this part will be used in this part P, but here is an eccentricity of 0.75 inch. Determine the horizontal deflection of the top of the column and the maximum normal stress in the column. Horizontal deflection at the top of the column. This column will buckle like this. So this horizontal deflection y maximum is required. We have already derived an expression for y maximum and sigma maximum. We have already derived expressions for sigma maximum also. So in this case, horizontal deflection in case of beams is y already, always remember it. So we have to find y maximum and sigma maximum. In columns, horizontal deflection is y, buckling. In columns, horizontal direction is y actually. Okay, first part is very simple. It is a centric load. One end of the column is fixed, other end is free. And since the column is of square cross section, I is same in both the planes. So we do not need to consider in which plane the buckling is going to happen. It is same in both the planes. So we will simply use effective length for a column one end fixed, other end free. Effective length for such columns is 2L. Here is it. A column with one end fixed and other end free. LE is equal to 2 times the given length. So 2 times into 8 feet, it is 16 feet, or in inches, it will be 192 inches. For centric loading, we use Euler formula. P critical is equal to pi square EI over LE square. Everything is given. E is given. I is given. LE has been calculated here. So we can put the values. Convert everything into pounds and inches. So P critical has been found as 62.1 kilopounds. We have to find P allowable, RP. P allowable is equal to P critical divided by factor of safety. 62.1 divided by factor of safety is 2. So P allowable is 13.1. We were asked to find sigma allowable. So sigma allowable will be P allowable divided by area. P allowable has been calculated as 31.1 kilopounds. Area is given here, which is 3.54 square inch. By putting all the values, sigma allowable becomes 8.79 kilopounds per square inch, or 8.79 into 10 power 3 pounds per square inch. Okay, the first part is already solved. For the second part, we have to find y maximum. P is known now. It is 13.1 kilopounds. Eccentricity is known, 0.75 inch. C is known, 2 inches. R is known, 1.5. I is given 8 inch power 4. So we can put all the values in the expression of y maximum, which has been derived earlier, this one, for eccentric loading. It is very simple. The numerical problems of this chapter are very simple. You just know the case, the type of beam and the type of loading, either it is centric or eccentric, or the beam is fixed at both ends, or pinned at both ends, or fixed at one end, fixed on the other end free, or one end fixed, other end pinned. You know the type of beam, you know the type of loading, and you just apply the corresponding formula. We are applying the formula for y maximum, putting all the values. Everything is known. P is known, P critical is known, E is known, and we have found y maximum equal to 0.939. Where the y is maximum in a beam with one end fixed and other end free, it is at the free end. Horizontal deflection of the free end. And it was asked in the problem to determine the horizontal deflection of the top of the column. Okay, then we were asked to find maximum normal stress. So again, expression for maximum normal stress is known. Either you use this one, or you use this one, or you start from here. It depends upon you. We will put all the values in the general expression of maximum stress. Everything is known. P is known. Area is given. E is given. C is given. R is given. P critical is given. Sorry, it is. It has been found in the first part. So by putting all the values, sigma maximum has been calculated as 22 kilopounds per square inch. You can do the calculations by yourself. So we have discussed the eccentric loading case as well in this chapter. This is all. We have discussed stability of the columns under centric loading and eccentric loading. We have found the critical load for columns under centric load using either formula, and then we have found the deflection or the buckling in the column y maximum under eccentric load and sigma maximum under eccentric load. Similarly, we have found sigma maximum or sigma critical for the beams under critical load, under centric load. We have discussed four types of columns having different boundary conditions. We have derived initial expression for columns with both ends pinned. Then we know that the general expression, we have decided that the general expression has a term LE, effective length, and we from literature we know the effective length for each type of column. We will use these expressions in our numerical problems for the corresponding columns. I hope this is clear. This is a very easy chapter. Everything is very simple. At the end of the chapter, in the exercise, there are some problems. I have chosen some of the problems to be discussed at the end of this lecture. Problem number 10.17, 10.21. Here you can see a column is horizontal. Okay, 10.23, 10.24, 10.36, and 10.39. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 problems. I will make a separate video for the solution of these problems. You can find it in my on my YouTube as well. So up till now, this is enough. This chapter was about theory of the columns. I hope it was easy for all of you. If you find any difficulty, you can contact me on my email address given here, or you can contact me through my different contacts, contact information is given on my website, Google website. The lectures, the PDF slides of these lectures are also available on my Google website. You can visit it. I hope this was enough. See you during the next lecture.